This episode of PodCRASH is presented with limited commercial interruption. Although I don't actually have a lot of commercials on PodCRASH. I do have a lot of plugs, but I'll be interrupting the show far less than I normally do. Now let's start.
Internet, beer, porn, TV, video games.
Yeah, that's insidious.
Yes,
can't you see that that's insidious?
It's like the exodus of the dads.
You boys are going to do the fucking dishes.
Right?
What's your OCD nightmare?
Why am I collecting these hunks of plastic? Woman is not a couch.
I love that a woman would do that too. I'm afraid I sound like a maudlin cunt.
My fear is that I really am an asshole.
So what is it going to take to make you happy, Chris?
Welcome to the show. I am That Chris Gore. This is PodCRASH. This is the show where you get to hear me as a guest each week on a different podcast. It gives you a chance to discover new podcasts. It gives me an opportunity to talk about a variety of topics. This week, Mental Illness Happy Hour, hosted by Paul Gilmartin. Oh yeah, we're going to be talking about mental illness issues. Before we get to that, I want to say that this is a very special episode for me. This is episode 52, and we've been putting out shows at about one a week. So that means it's been approximately a year, actually. A year ago, the first episode of PodCRASH came out, and I really wanted to kind of take stock of what's happened in the last year after sort of the year point, and I've been making little improvements in the show. I'm definitely not satisfied, which is a part of my flaw in my personality. I'm never quite happy with anything, but with this, I feel at least a sense of accomplishment. Hey, there's 52 episodes, people listening on a regular basis. I'm getting emails and letters from people, communicating with listeners on Twitter and just via all the social media. So I feel like we're doing some good. I've talked to a lot of people who've actually found out about some other podcasts by listening to my show, which is good. So, I mean, that was the whole point. There's a Venn diagram of people who like me and then people who like other shows. They're going to find out about a different show every week. So the 52nd episode is something that means a lot to me. Before we talk about Mental Illness Happy Hour and Paul Gilmartin and what amazing podcast that is, a couple of things. PodCRASH has been nominated for two Stitcher Awards. Best Album Art, which I think is pretty cool, because my face is part of that art. So Best Album Art. And then Best New Show. I did this campaign to get nominated. Now that I've been nominated, I'm afraid to bug people to vote for me, because if you vote for me, and I'm tweeting about it, or I'm retweeting people, or I'm posting it, I have in the past made fun of people for tweeting or begging to get votes for something. Because ultimately, what does this really mean? What it really, because I have this fear that first of all, I don't think I'm going to win anything because I'm up against some amazing shows. Aisha Tyler's show and Jay Moore, More Stories, and other great shows are in the Best New Show category. I have no chance. I mean, Aisha Tyler's got like, what, a couple million followers on Twitter. She's a hot, attractive woman. Jay Moore is just look, people that are more famous than me. I really don't have much of a shot. So if I win in the category, I'm just going to be, I'm going to be stressing that, hey, I won this because I bothered people to vote for me more, not because I actually deserve it as Best New Show. So I hope the people who are voting on Stitcher are listening to episodes. I voted in a whole bunch of different categories for all kinds of different podcasts. And, if you vote for me, cool. If not, whatever. I think just to be nominated and actually, you know, in that category of Best New Show with people, you know, like Aisha Tyler and Jay Moore just feels like an honor. It's kind of like, this is what reminds me of, you know, at Thanksgiving when you were a kid and you sat at the kids' table. And then eventually you were like, oh, well, I'm old enough now. I finally, you know, does someone have to die for me to get actually at the adult table? Then finally you move from the kids' table to the adult table. And you're sitting with all the adults. And then you realize, I really miss the kids' table. I also have to tell you about the 2012 PodCRASH Awards. That's Saturday, November 10th, 6:30 p.m. cocktails, 7 p.m. is the show, 8:15 p.m. is the VIP after party. There's a limited number of tickets available to the public. Most of the people in attendance are actually going to be some of the podcasts that are nominated, because all the podcasts that I've appeared on are actually up for awards. It's kind of a comedy sketch awards show, which I guarantee a good time. You're going to have a blast. So go to ioimprov.com/west. You can get tickets, or also go to facebook.com/podcrash. There's an event page, RSVP, and pick up your advance tickets and come to this show. This will probably be our last live show for 2012. You are definitely going to want to be there on Saturday, November 10th.
The 2012 Podcrash Awards. It's very prestigious.
Okay, so I appeared on a podcast called The Mental Illness Happy Hour, and when my producer, Sean Merrick, who does an amazing amount of prep work on this show, he does so much in terms of the bookings and just in the post and putting together all the clips, he surprised me with this. I actually said, look, I'm having some issues in my life. I'd like to be on a podcast where I'll be examined. I actually asked him to go after some a mental illness podcast, something about psychology, something. And how do I not know about this? Mental Illness Happy Hour, hosted by Paul Gilmartin, who's a comedian. Dinner and a Movie is a show that he appears on with Janet Varney. He's hilarious guy. He's also into hockey. We didn't get a chance to talk about hockey on the show. We talked about issues, but I wish I'd gotten a chance to talk to him about hockey. But I mentioned at the top of the show that there would be limited interruption. That's for a very specific reason, because there's really not much I can say in the wraparounds for this show in terms of commentary. I usually comment about, you know, what the podcast was like, or fill in some piece of information. I don't have a lot to say, except that I wanted to be on this show because I've been dealing with a lot of issues. You hear little things come up every once in a while, but I feel like I'm in this sort of enormous amount of change in my life, whether it be I went through a breakup this year, had to move suddenly. My dad's been experiencing health issues that has been ongoing all year. In addition to the fact that I don't feel so secure in my job at the moment, I've spent the last 3 years trying to change my career from the film guy, because I've been known as the film threat guy. You hear film threat come up on the show probably every other show. I try to cut it out. I try to make sure that it's not, but it invariably film threat, because it was 25 years, it was 25 years of my career was doing film threat. So I am the film guy, the film threat guy, but let me just clue you in. The job of film critic is dead. I mean, that is going away. It's really become this mass Twitter, between Twitter and social media and people, you know, posting on the internet. That's how people get opinions about movies now. It's really just going to Rotten Tomatoes and looking at the score. It's not reading any in-depth film criticism. So I used to write and speak a lot about film. I mean, I still do weekly on Attack of the Show. But I feel like that's going away. That whole job, that job title is actually going to disappear. Which is really sad, unfortunately. I think there'll still be passionate people writing about it and talking about it, but that's good. So, point is, my careers, I got life turmoil, I got family turmoil, okay? And then I've got, you know, my job. I'm trying to change things. I'm trying to turn the tide into another direction in what I'm doing. I never even wanted to be on TV, actually. I kind of fell into that. So now what I'm doing is I'm actually doing the things I want to do. And the podcast is actually part of that, doing this podcast. And the animated shows that I've been working on, which you've heard about in the past, Fetishville and this other one, Last Guys on Earth. And there's some other secret projects I have. I've been working on these for a while. So I'm launching my career in a completely different direction, along with a comedy album that'll be coming out early in 2013. So... But to do that, to be the guy that you thought of one way, and then to do stuff, I feel like I have to do, I have my, whatever I do is got, I've got to work on 10 times as hard as anybody else, just because I feel like I'll be so criticized to be, you were that movie guy, and now you're just going to be, you're trying to be a comedian, you better be funny, Chris Gore, and so that is always going through my head. I've got to be twice as good as the next guy, or else I'll be constantly attacked. Which I don't care about the attacks. What I do care about is actually delivering a good show whenever I get up on stage, or whenever I get in front of this microphone and I'm speaking to you directly. So, um, So there's a lot of stuff going on. Career, family life, love life is all swirling around, and nothing is exactly in a good place. So I wanted to seek out a show like this. Couldn't believe it. When I discovered Paul Gilmartin's show, I listened to probably 15 episodes over the course of a weekend. I just had it on. I just kept the next one. It was like chips. I was just listening to it. It was amazing to me just the amount of insight that he has on this. He really knows, he really knows his stuff. And in addition, you hear some of the funniest people on his show really opening up. I mean, they come to play. I really do think there is something about comedians in terms of being vulnerable. And I'm not saying I am in a class with some of the people who have been in Paul Gilmartin's show. There's been amazing people on his show. I'm not ready to call myself a comedian yet. It's part of my, all right, it's in my bio, but I'm not 100% believe. See, this will come up on Paul's show, is what I think about myself. So in any case, I wanted to be on a show to talk about a bunch of these issues and what I was going through. But having listened to his show, it's an amazing. I mean, I felt better actually listening to a whole weekend of it. So he actually came over to my house in this garage. I have like this sort of crafting garage where I do a lot of the weird craft projects that pop up on Twitter every once in a while. I'll post pictures. Paul Gilmartin came over, amazing guy, had his whole cool setup, and we recorded for like 2 hours. This is the only time, I do a lot of podcasts. This is the only time I've actually listened to a podcast I've appeared on. Because once I've been on a podcast, I know what I said. I know pretty much the gist of the conversation, or I repeated a story, or I said this, I got in my plugs, whatever. Oh, I remember that funny thing I said, that could be a bit, blah, blah, blah. So when I was on Paul's show, it was like a blur. It was a blur of, I mean, I was on autopilot with him. So for the very first time, when the show came out, like a month or so later, I listened to the show, and I had a lot of, it was strange to hear myself talk about these issues. I felt I grew somewhat from that, and I feel I've transcended some of what's been discussed, but a lot of that never really goes away. So here it is, Paul Gilmartin's Mental Illness Happy Hour, not just a podcast. This is a service to anyone going through tough times.
If you could see the space that we're recording in right now, it's Chris's craft room at the back of his house, and it is a nerd wet dream. It is I don't even know how to describe it. There's all kinds of electronics. There's a video game. There's a gigantic skull. There's a bust of some old dude from the 1700s.
You would recognize that. It's William Shakespeare. That's a prop replica from the original Batman TV series from the 1960s.
Oh, my God.
And the head even tilts back.
Is that like to open the thing?
To open the door to the bat poles where they would,
right.
Batman and Robin would then, Bruce Wayne and Dick Grayson would then turn into Batman and Robin.
I didn't know that was Shakespeare's head that they.
That was William Shakespeare. It's a faux bust.
I'm sorry. I started to, I interrupted you, but I so wanted to paint the picture for the listener to be able to.
I like to think it's a manly crafting environment. It's kind of like, my friends have described me as like a Martha Stewart for nerds.
That's so awesome. And if you saw this, you would completely agree. And I get that. There is something so narcotic-like about having a space. For me, it's my garage and woodworking, and there's something so narcotic about just having this place where you can go escape and let that part of your brain that you don't know where it's coming from, you just let it go when you follow it.
Absolutely. And I think there's something to having all this stuff. I mean, I recently went through a huge purge of all kinds of, why am I collecting these hunks of plastic? They're going to all be in a landfill and they're going to be worthless. And I used to justify it by saying that, like, you know, I could go to a therapist and find out why I need to buy this stuff. And I could spend the money, $150 an hour, usually for therapy, or I could just own the stuff. And I'd rather have the stuff.
Yeah,
but I think now, actually, just being healthy from a mental standpoint, it's just way more important to me. The stuff is, and it's never really been that important. Like when my kids,
were young, I buy two action figures, one to keep in the box and one to open and play with. After a while, I'm like, what am I doing? This is a waste of money. I could have.
You're not the only person I know that does that.
It's definitely, I think it's a generational thing because my kids don't care about that stuff. They don't collect. They are more into, they like to have things digital, but they'll take a CD, put it in their collection on iTunes and throw the CD away. They don't want to be burdened by things. And I think having moved a couple times in the last few years, I don't either. I'd like to get rid of all this stuff. So I've sort of whittled it down to the collection of things that are precious to me, but even then they're just things.
Well, I totally relate to the collecting thing, and I truly believe that it is our way of coping with anxiety. That's not to say that there isn't a genuine love of stuff that's in there, but as I've done work on myself and peeled the layers of the onion, as you call it, the intense desire to collect that I used to have has gone away. And because people, like, if you listen to an episode of the Walking the Room, which I was on, they asked me all these questions about my collecting, and I forgot how freaky and intense my collecting was. I won't go into it here, but let's just say that they were howling. They couldn't believe how ridiculous it was. And there is, while there's a quality of it that is awesome and drug-like, it can also begin to negatively impact your life. Have you ever found the collecting bug to negatively impact your life?
Absolutely, it's negatively affected my life. I feel when you value a material item over a relationship, that's when I think it negatively affects. In addition, it can negatively affect from a financial standpoint, where you're, I mean, I used to say in my head, like, why do I want to go to dinner? You know, why would I go to dinner? That's $60. That's an Xbox game, or that's like, you know, a Hot Toys 1/6 scale action figure of Batman. Like, but to me, going to dinner is not about the food. It's about having that relationship with the people in your life. And now I've really come to enjoy actually going to dinner with friends. And before I would anything that would be, why am I spending money on that? I could be buying things. And the things just aren't important to me. That really went away. But I do believe that people who are collectors are just hoarders that organize well.
That's brilliant.
Because one of my favorite tumblers is called Things Organized Neatly. I love, because I'm very OCD about things being alphabetized or being in their place and being organized. It's like an organized, I mean, I know where all my things are, right?
What's your OCD nightmare?
That someone will come over to my place and things are not organized. I mean, this is definitely not what I would want this place to be with you coming over, but I feel listening to your show that you would be understanding. But yeah, that's definitely my nightmare OCD scenario is just my stuff being in chaos. Like, you will never, every woman I've ever lived with has never had to wash my dishes, has never had to pick up my socks, or I do all that myself. I'm a man. I at least that's what I would say. I'm a man. I take care of my own stuff. But it's just about me wanting to have control of my own things. I think I definitely have. I think it's a control issue.
There was a guy in college that we lived near, and he was completely OCD. He would fold his underwear, fold his socks. His shaving cream can would be in a drawer, and the razor would be angled such that the can wouldn't roll when you open the drawer. And so when he would go to class, we would go into his room and just mess all his shit up.
Well, the funny thing is, I relate to that because all my stuff is not only organized, I will look at a space that whether it's my bathroom or whatever, and everything is not only in its place, it's in a place that is the most convenient, to the point where I could just go in that bathroom, close my eyes, I know exactly where everything is. Same thing with my car. I have places where I reach and there are certain things. I know exactly where they are. Like, I could grab this, that. And I had this girlfriend once who had an uncle who worked for NASA. His job was to design the compartments and the space on the space shuttle. He came to the small apartment that I had in Los Feliz and said, you set this up brilliant. And hearing that compliment from him, like, I really think about how is the space organized, where things are. It's sort of beyond feng shui. It's like I want the space to be the most convenient way. And also, it's a time saver.
It absolutely is. It's absolutely.
I know where things are, so I'm not looking for things. But also, this is an OCD, kind of ADD, OCD thing that I have, because I'm definitely ADD. As I've read some books on that, there's one, Driven from Distraction. There's two really good books about ADD that I've read. And in that book, there are 100 things that they ask you, yes or no, definitive yes or no questions about whether you have ADD or not. I answered, of the 100, 98 definitively yes.
Really?
I think I'm ADD. So this was about 8 years ago. But I've struggled with it my whole life, but never knew that I had it until about 7, 8 years ago when I started therapy after getting... I was in therapy, actually couples therapy, with my then wife, but then we ended up getting divorced. But I stuck with that therapist because I really liked him. So see, now this is an ADD thing.
Are you still in therapy with him?
Not in therapy with him, but a lot of the coping skills that I read about in this book, Driven from Distraction, I already was doing those things. I have to write things down. I have to make a list of everything.
Are you now in therapy with the person who alphabetically follows his name in the therapist directory?
No, but... I will on occasion. I have taken Adderall, and there's a new one that I'm trying now, although I don't like it because it lasts 12 hours and it's sort of time release. So it's like when you take it out, sort of a window of 12 hours. But it is, for me, like putting on a pair of glasses. I see things in my mind in a more clear way.
What is the nightmare for you? Let's just kind of walk through. Let's say all your stuff is organized and somebody comes through like I did to that guy in college and I mess everything up and everything is out of its place. Just close your eyes and what are the fears that you think are going to come true when nothing is in its place?
I won't be able to find something when I need it. And just to back up a bit, because this is an ADD thing, I start to tell a story and I segue into another story, which I think is why I think I'm better as a guest than a host of a podcast. But I have to have a bowl. It's usually a decorative bowl. Could be a silver bowl, glass bowl. That's where my keys go. I always will, when I enter a space, I have to have stuff in the same place. If I can't find something, that will drive me crazy.
What are the feelings that come up when you can't find something?
Fear that I've lost it. Fear that I will never retrieve that item. So I have had to create these things, like having a bowl at my door, which is where I always put my stuff.
What are some seminal events in your life other than the divorce of your parents?
I would say the death of my grandparents, but it wasn't...
Did it happen at the same time?
No, they were... my grandmother, my Mima... died of cancer after my grandfather. This was several years after my grandfather, but the regret I have about my grandfather was I had just moved to Los Angeles. I was back and forth. My daughter was, you know, about to be born, but I would go back to Michigan fairly frequently when I first moved to Los Angeles. And I went back and I was talking to my grandfather and it was like, hey, you know, I'll see you tomorrow, whatever. I'm going to hang out with some friends. We were supposed to get together and I, you know, decided I'm going to hang out with my friends. I'll see you later, Grandpa, because I will always see my grandpa. And that night he had a stroke. The next time I saw him, he was laying in the hospital and half of his face, you know, was drooping, like as happens, you know, with stroke victims. He kind of recognized me. I mean, he was in tears and I remember just holding his hand and looking at him and he couldn't speak. And it was, I mean, just a short time later he died, but I regret not going to see him that day.
Which I think is totally normal. I think that's the first place people go to because the emotion that comes up is so intense. You need some place to direct it. And the place we usually direct it is at ourselves. And I mean, hopefully you can understand looking back on it that you did nothing wrong. There was no way that you could have known that.
Looking back, but at the same time, I think, you know, I never had that last conversation. I never had that last hug. I never had that last, I love you, you know, none of that.
Did you get to say stuff to him?
I did. I did in the hospital. I'm just not sure how he was, whether he, you know, was able to understand.
I think if he had tears in his eyes, he probably understood what was going on. He was probably lucid.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and I've read a lot about...
Unless he had just been pepper sprayed.
Right, exactly. But, I mean, I love my grandparents because they had such a great sense of humor. They not only were effectively my surrogate parents when my parents got initially divorced, they kind of checked out and were doing their own thing. This was the 70s, so that was, let's find ourselves.
A lot of key parties.
Yeah, key parties and selfishness. And now I think the way selfishness is manifested is in our online personas and look at me kind of stuff.
And I think there's good selfishness and there's bad selfishness.
Right. I agree with that. There's definitely self-preservation selfishness that's actually a good thing, keeping yourself and from bad influences.
And feeding yourself and making sure you have time for yourself.
Absolutely. You know, both emotionally and physically in those respects. But but my grandparents really stepped in and they were just, I mean, they grew up during Depression era where, you know, they'd have a potato would be a family of six. You know, they had to, that's what they had to eat. I mean, they were Polish and Russian. And their sense of humor was amazing through all of their struggles. My God, I remember this one time where my grandfather was reading us a scary story. And I had my friends over. This was what was funny was all of the kids in this particular neighborhood, I had told you that like, invariably, all of the kids, suddenly the dads disappeared. It was like the exodus of the dads. So all the kids in the neighborhood, when my grandparents came and sort of stepped in, they would come and stay at our house for a few days with me and my sister, all of the kids gravitated towards them because they didn't have the strong, you know, male figure in their life. They didn't have strong mothers. The mothers were all devastated from this. And they kind of took over. So,
and women were also going through a real sea change in the 70s. If for people that weren't alive then, you know, for some of our younger listeners, like I remember my mom all of a sudden saying, you know what? You boys are going to do the fucking dishes.
I did the dishes. I, you know, but it was definitely a change for women, for sure. I mean, that was, and I think in the long run has been a good thing.
Absolutely.
But at the time, really, my grandparents were the heroes in our neighborhood. And I would actually be able to bring several friends. I mean, they would beg, like, please, let's go. We want to go to your grandparents' house because they lived in Grand Blanc, Michigan, which was kind of more in the middle of the country. And they'd take us cherry picking and we'd go feed the deer and they'd make us work, actually. They would make us do a lot of work and it was hard. And I remember complaining and then thinking like, hey, I really learned a lot doing that. So my grandfather's reading us this scary, scary story. And it's on the second floor of their house. And in the scary story, it was about a ghost that would come and knock on the door. And we're sitting there. And we hear a bang, bang, bang outside of the second floor window. We freaked out. My friends and I are screaming. We run downstairs. My grandmother had climbed on the outside of the roof of the house, gone out there, and they planned this in advance to scare the crap out of us. We were dying. But this is the lengths that they would go to play practical jokes on us. It was amazing. You know?
Oh, my God. That must have scared the shit out of you.
It definitely did. It definitely did because he built up this whole thing. And they were, you know, it was one of those things where they were storytellers. And he was in the Navy. They were, you know, it was one of those things where he was in World War II. And they used to do that thing where I remember reading my grandparents' letters to each other. Love letters that would just make you sob. Because, I mean, what they would do, I heard about this thing where if you were in the Navy, right, what you would do is you would keep a journal of what, you know, where you were away from your wife. You know, there's no internet, there's no phones, there's no mode of communication. They would keep journals. Your wife would keep a journal. And then when you get back, there'd be a lot of sex, no time to talk. And they would just exchange journals.
Really?
So that's how couples in the military during that period of time were able to know. And much of it was mundane. But then it was you got to experience exactly what was going on with the other person. And that's how marriages stayed strong during that time. I think it's a beautiful concept.
Wow. I'd never heard of that. That's amazing.
My grandparents were married 50 years. So, and I actually, they renewed their vows at 50 years and I did the service. I remarried them.
That's beautiful.
So they're my heroes I definitely see elements. I think my whole family has a great sense of humor. So, and I see, like, whether it's in my, you know, when I look at, like, stuff I've written or just comedy and stuff, my sense of humor has always come from that, you know, that environment. That just, we just would make fun of each other a lot.
I can't tell you how many people I've come across whose emotional well-being was really rescued or saved by their grandparents because the parents just were too fucked up.
I guess it does take a village. I mean, but they also came from a different era. So their parenting, they were tougher on me, and that's what I needed.
But there was also love in there?
Oh, absolutely. I never wanted to disappoint them. I wanted to pick all the cherries. I wanted to do the task that was in front of me. I wanted to, I wanted to please them for sure. So I see how that today even affects me of it's, if I disappoint another person, whether it be someone in my life, whether it be my kids or whether it be an audience who watches, who, likes what I do in some form of entertainment, I have a desire to please.
What would it be like when you would disappoint them? Was it punishment or were they just disappointed in that feeling that they had ate at you?
Oh, that disappointing them was the worst possible thing.
Can you remember any particular instances?
I remember, whether it be like grades or something, but I was actually really good in school, so that wasn't a difficult
thing. That's not a shocker.
Yeah, I did okay in school. I did okay. I didn't know when I had to tell me to do my homework. I wanted to do it. So I just had the ability to, I could read and just remember everything. Now, post having kids, my memory's awful. My memory's the worst. And I feel like, and I've heard this before, I've read where when you have kids, it's such an emotional experience that for some people who have kids, not everybody, it basically, it's like your brain is reformatted. It reformats your brain where a certain chunk of your brain is used for your kids. So I know that I can mark when I had kids, my memory went down the tubes. But one of the biggest cases where I disappointed my grandparents was my mom was out of town. I knew the house was going to be, I was a teenager, so I was probably 16, 17 at the time. And I had a party at my house. And there was beer and there were kids in high school and I was popular. Why? Because I was the house where you could go and they were drinking beer. And my grandparents came by and they didn't tell me. They saw what was happening at the house and they called the cops on me. And so, and then they called to tell me, never do that again because we're not going to come in and break up the party. The cops will. So I felt horrible. I never did that again. It had an effect on me for sure.
Wow.
Yeah. I did not want to disappoint my grandparents.
I just flashed on a memory that I had where my grandmother was sitting for us and she's sitting in the family room watching TV and the kitchen is right behind her, and the kitchen has a sliding glass door that leads to outside, and there are stairs in the kitchen that lead to downstairs, and I was having people over, and we slid the sliding door open and carried a keg of beer in behind my grandmother, and I thought I had, all under control, and at a certain point, I think after the 40th, trip to the bathroom by somebody to pee, she said, I know what you're doing down there. She never told my parents, but...
But my parents had when it came to alcohol, they were, okay, if you're going to do it, just be at home and don't drive, And on occasion, before I was 21, or wait a sec, was the drinking age different then? This was the 70s. I think it might have been 18, actually. And then they raised it to 21, now that I think about it. But my mom allowed me a few choice times to okay, you can have that, but you're not going anywhere. You're in my sight.
Yeah.
So... It also made it not taboo.
Do you feel like doing a fear off? Is there any other stuff that you want to talk about or touch on?
No, I really feel like we hit a lot. I mean, I just feel that whenever I go through a phase, I feel like I'm going through a phase right now, currently in my life.
Let's talk about that.
I'm at a weird crossroads. I'm feeling an urgency because I'm 46 years old. I can get away with, my hair gives me away, but I can get away with looking younger. But I'm at that stage and I'm like, hey, all the things I wanted to do, I haven't done a bunch of those things yet. And I really have this whole...
That shocks me because you seem like the kind of guy who, you sleep 6 hours a night. You got your own craft room. You've created your own magazine. I mean, fuck. Most of us look at guys like you and go... Why can't I be like that guy that starts his own magazine?
Here's a funny story. I dropped out of college, not because I wanted to, because my parents were fighting about who should actually pay to support me through college. And I'm sitting here, hey, I'd like to finish college. got 2 years in, and between the financial aid and me working three jobs, I said, I have to quit. I have to drop out. Also, there was sort of a sense from my standpoint of like, look, I'm not trying to be a surgeon. I am paying a lot of money for books I could buy on my own, read, and then know that stuff. And I read a book on how to publish a magazine, and I said, you know what? I'm just going to start my own magazine. But here's the irony. I dropped out of college. Years later, I wrote a book about film festivals. That's how to take your independent film and sort of independently market it and sell it at a film festival. And people like Morgan Spurlock have read my book. Jared Hess, who did Napoleon Dynamite, they've read the book and it's helped them sell their movies.
Really?
Now my book is required reading in college. Independent film studies, but I'm a college dropout. So that I'm very proud of. However, I didn't get into this. I got in this to make media, make films. And I've produced a comedy called My Big Fat Independent Movie, which was mildly received by the critics. But I just have this impending thing where, like, I haven't done this stuff. Like, why do I not have more money? Why am I not more successful? Why am I not able? My kids are in college. One of my kids is in college now. I really can't help her as much as I would like. So I have this, I think was the destruction of my last relationship was specifically because of this sense that I'm in a race to achieve some kind of success that I haven't gotten to yet. And my last relationship, I put so much attention on these new career goals I set for myself that I ignored the relationship, and she broke up with me, and we were living together for a year. I thought I was going to get remarried, and I moved out. So there's all kinds of pleasant things happening.
I think that is one of the most common struggles that people have, is we all have such an intense fear about financial survival, and we also have an intense need to be loved and to be in a healthy relationship. And where is that line? How do we know how to give each thing its own energy?
Well, it's weird. Like, I feel I'm very regimented in my life. I have lists and things, and I give myself permission to slide on deadlines. That's procrastination, I say, is part of my writing process. But I think that one is fairly common among writers. But I just felt this impending, like, oh my God, you know, like, I don't think I'm going to be at my current job forever. You know, I've been there for 7 years.
At G4.
I don't think I'm going to be there forever. I think, you know, and that's fine. You know, 7 years is the longest running job I've had in TV. And as you know, working in television, I do like two seasons. Usually shows I'm on, they last about 2 years. I'm grateful for the work. I understand it's a freelance business. People that aren't in entertainment don't understand that. It's always a struggle. But the goals I've set for myself, I haven't achieved those. So the last couple of years, I feel like it's been a race. And then I get into this thing where it's like, oh, well, because I've had three relationships, serious relationships post-divorce. Three women I thought, hey, this is serious. And the last one I thought was the one that would work out the best. I know that I've done this. And of course, it's the thing where it's like you learn the lesson when it's too late. I feel like when I've got a relationship, I look on that like I've got a couch. Not that I look on the woman who's in my life as a material thing, but it's like, got a couch. Don't need to buy another couch. I've got that couch. It's handled. It's in the living room. It's there. Woman is not a couch. A woman is someone who needs, I mean, they need attention and love more than a plant or a pet, for sure. And it's something that has to be maintained and it has to be reconfirmed constantly. And I don't do that. I have seen how I think, that's okay. Like, you know, the last week I've been unavailable to you, whether it be time-wise or whatever, but it festers in the relationship. The woman feels she's not getting attention. And
I think that's one of the most common mistakes people make in a relationship, is they think once that person has accepted you, once they've let you sleep with them, okay, I've done my part. And that's the biggest mistake. All it means is you've won their trust.
Yeah.
Well, but you need to keep their trust every day by feeding that relationship. And that's, for some reason, I don't know why so many of us, and I include myself, the biggest complaint my wife has is I took her for granted in doing something. I wasn't considerate. And I totally get that. I totally get that.
What's your wife's name? Maybe I was, maybe I knew, know her. That has been a recurring thing. I've noticed like, wow, I kind of do the same thing in every relationship. I get in the relationship. It's solid. I Mr. Perfect boyfriend, perfect husband, whatever it is. And then I fail.
So listening to this stuff from Paul's show and listening to me talk about this stuff really... It does give me some insights, and having gone through some tough times in the past, there's actually something my mom gave me. I've actually always been interested in self-help, whether it be books, you know, the 4-hour work week or, the Nerdist Way is a good, book by Chris Hardwick. There's a lot of good self-help books out there, and I'll usually get some sort of piece of advice where, oh, I'm going to integrate that into what I do. Or there'll be a kernel that I actually write down. It's something I'll write it down in a post-it note and I'll put it near my computer. And it'll be something that I just focus on it, and good things can happen from that. Or at least it will remind me of something, like not to say which I say too much on the show. Anyways, so my mom gave me this book years ago that is out of print. It's called 30 Days to a Better Life. This book is out of print. I've looked for it on Amazon. I've looked for it everywhere. It does not exist. And I've had friends, recently had a friend actually, who tried to commit suicide. And, he went back home to West Virginia, where he's now living with his parents. And we all thought that, he actually did try to commit suicide, talked to him in the hospital. It's one of the things I wish I had given this to him sooner, knowing he was going through some tough relationship issues. This book that my mom gave me, 30 Days to a Better Life, I've given to a lot of friends. Now, what I've done is I've actually scanned the book. Because it's out of print, I don't feel guilty doing this. There's no way to get this book anywhere. I've scanned the book. So it's just a Word file, and it's 60 pages. The book is really interesting because each chapter is like 2 pages. So there'll be a little anecdote and then an exercise. So it's something that when I've gone through a breakup, I'll read this book, but I've never actually finished the book. And I'll tell you why. Because every day there's a lesson, and then there's something you have to do. So I'll read it in the morning, and then I'll focus on that thing and kind of write, I got to write that list down. Oh, I'll think about that. And by the time, and it's stuff like, you know, make a list of things you like about yourself. I could make that. A list of things you don't like about yourself. I'm going to need more paper. You know, so by the time I get to like 2 weeks into the book, I get to like, you know, day 14, 15, or 16, I feel pretty good about myself. I'm actually kind of over whatever it is was dragging me down, you know, because listening to the show may make you think that I'm a person that gets depressed. I will limit myself to a certain period where it's like, okay, you're allowed to actually feel sad. Now you actually have to move on. You've got to move on. So I have this book, and I've never finished the book. I've never gotten maybe 2/3 into it. However, if anyone out there is actually going through something, if you are having trouble right now, I will email you a copy of this book. I highly recommend it, in addition to Paul Gilmartin's podcast. It's 30 Days to a Better Life. Just email podcrashwiththatchrisgore@gmail.com. Say, send me the 30 Days book, and I will email that to you personally. So podcrashwiththatchrisgore@gmail.com. In fact, you can ask any question, which I will answer on the podcast. But if you're specifically interested in this book, I'll email it to you. It's helped me out a lot. It's helped out friends of mine. I did end up sending it to my friend of mine who is going through an incredibly tough time. So I've just seen what an impact that book has had on people, because it's very simple. It's very simple. I mean, there's some religious overtones in a little bit. Don't let that turn you off. At all, for those people that are offended by organized religion. I'm not so offended. I think, hey, you know what? As a self-help book, read some religious books out there. There's some great self-help in there. This also can drive you crazy. But I'm not trying to get into a religious discussion right now. I'm just saying anyone that would like a copy of this book, email me at podcrashwiththatchrisgore@gmail.com. Say, send me that 30 days book, and I will email it back to you. It's helped out myself. It's helped out a lot of friends in my life. That's why I scanned it, because there's only one copy of this book and I can't find it. I would have bought it for some friends if it was available. So, okay, let's get back to Mental Illness Happy Hour with Paul Gilmartin.
What is it going to take to make you happy, Chris?
A healthy relationship, debt-free, and then working on something where I'm behind the scenes and not on camera. I'm going to write that down. That's going to be, because I have to write it down. When you're ADD, you have to write everything down. And I will, if I'm going to bed and I know I can't sleep, the thing that will help me get to sleep is like, okay, write it down. I get it out of my head. It's like, oh, it's on paper now. I can go to sleep because I don't want to forget it.
Let me ask you this. Have you ever felt that you are okay, that you are in that place where you can then relax? Because I have the feeling you've never allowed yourself to be there, and you're living under the illusion that it's going to happen. But unless you can feel that at this very moment, and until you can learn how to feel that you're okay in this moment, it's going to be this carrot that you're going to keep chasing.
Unequivocally, without thinking, absolutely never. I have never felt that I've been successful. I've never felt that I can relax. I've always thought about, like, even when it comes to whatever the business is, like, well, we got to start a YouTube channel. We got to start this. There's always, like, the next thing I'm kind of adding because it's not enough. It's not enough.
Yes.
And I feel like I've had even friends tell me, it's like, you know, you don't have to work that hard at it. You can just have it be this, and it's fine.
You've got a roof over your head. We're in an air-conditioned room. Your kids were grilling hot dogs out there. You've got food to eat. They're taken care of. Your girl is in college.
Right. My kids aren't my daughter's not pregnant. My kids aren't on drugs. And I'm really proud of the fact that they have friends, like really good friends. Like my kids they're not racist assholes or bullies. But at the same time, I have not made it. I think it's maybe because of the moniker that, you know, it's like, oh yeah, you're that film critic who started Film Thread. It's like, no, I've written books. I've made movies. I've, you know, created television shows. And I feel like an asshole pointing out, I feel like an asshole often, but I feel like more of an asshole pointing out, it's like, I'm all these other things. You just know me as this one thing. But you know, in an entertainment career, people can only know you as one thing. Like, you're that guy, you're X. And then they know you as this thing.
Yes.
You do comedy, or you do this thing.
I'm going to just stop you for a second.
Sure.
I know a little bit about addiction and compulsive thinking. Trust me. I don't know many things in this world. This I absolutely know. Until you can get to the point where you can accept where you are in your life, at this very moment, no matter what is going on, you're going to keep chasing that myth. Because even if you get those things that you think are going to allow you to calm down, the second you get them, they're either not going to be enough, or your obsession is then going to turn to your fear of losing them. And you're never going to, you have to give yourself the permission to relax. Now, that is way easier said than done. I have to meditate. I have to pray. I have to go to support groups. I have to do a lot of other stuff. I'm not saying that you have to do those things, but I'm saying it is, you're chasing a ghost.
Well, I justify, first of all, everything you said, absolutely true. Like, I've even said that out loud. Like, but I justify that feeling in my mind is like, I need this bad feeling about myself because that's what pushes me. So I'm going to always be in a state of discontent.
That's
where I'll always stay.
That's a lie, because then it ruins your relationships with other people, because when you're at dinner with them, your mind is spinning about what your next project, and it degrades the quality of your presence with other human beings.
It's even worse during sex. I could just tell you that from a fact. Is it, yeah. When you're coming up with ideas for, like, I got to do that thing with my podcast. Yeah,
that's insidious.
Yes,
can't you see that that's insidious?
I do now with you telling me you should charge to be on this podcast. This is that good. This is better than that $150 an hour I've spent.
That's just because I'm so fucked up. I've had to live all of these things. I've had to bump my head into a wall. None of this is by any brilliant insight on my own. I have just made so many mistakes in my life. When I see somebody else, and not to call what you're doing a mistake, it's just, it's wasted energy. You're okay as you are.
I'll get there. I'll get there. Like, just, I, you know, your podcast has been, first of all, I have to compliment you, that has been a service to the community. I mean, I blew through a weekend where I listened to like 15 episodes, comedians I knew, people I didn't know. It's just amazing how the insight that you have, how revealing you are. And I want to thank you just for just doing this podcast.
Well, guess what? My numbers are never enough.
Yes.
There's a perfect example.
Yeah.
That's how sick this is.
How come you're not number one on iTunes in the comedy category? You know, I'll bop up every once in a while. My podcast will be in the top 100. It's like, oh, okay, cool. I'm 92. What does that mean? I don't know. But like, yeah, you're right. Yeah, I'm with you. Like, I'm always checking, like, well, where am I at now? Mm-hmm. Why is that number not bigger? Yeah.
So even knowing that I have that sickness inside me, that still, it's still difficult. And I think part of the reason is, A, it's just a difficult thing because, for one, our society programs us to believe that our accomplishments are who we are, and that's where we gain our validation from. And two, I think we get a little bit of a hit when we get a little bit of that goal accomplished, but it's fleeting. And I think our souls need something. I think that's candy for our soul. And I think our souls need meat and potatoes. And for me, meaning, purpose, is that meat and potatoes. That is the only thing that's ever filled that hole in me and allowed me to calm down and feel like me talking to you right now is meat and potatoes. I feel like I was put on this earth to talk about what I'm talking about, be here right now with you. I'm sure you've had feelings when you are with your kids where you know there's no other place in the world you're meant to be and you feel bliss and completely. So to me, life is about stringing together as many of those moments as possible and quieting that part of my brain that tells me I'm blowing it. I've fucked up. I've slept too late too many days in a row. I've made the wrong decisions. I'm not enough. I don't have enough and I'm not doing enough.
Well, isn't awareness half the battle? Right?
It is. It's the first step, is being aware of it. And I just hear in your voice a panic that makes me feel like you need to be reminded that you are enough, that you are doing enough, that you have enough.
It's so funny that you, I mean, you're really tuned in. I mean, you are someone who can read people in just by their vibe, their presence, you're very observational. Yes, I do. That is exactly, that's actually why I wanted to be on your podcast, was just to talk about this. Why am I going through this? I feel like, I describe it to a friend as like the physical feeling is that like I'm taking a battleship, right? And I am trying to turn it 180 degrees in another direction. And it's like this, and I can't turn it no matter what I do, no matter how much effort. In fact, more effort actually makes it more difficult to turn.
Yes. Why not go with the direction that it's in and celebrate? And when I remember that, I have the best time. I have the best fucking time.
Well, it's interesting. Where I lose myself and that feeling goes away is when I see movies. Movies, or, you know, there's so much great television, that as well. When I get caught up in other stories, I stop thinking about myself. And when I've had some really dark times, post-breakup usually, I just do volunteer work. That's what gets me. Like, any volunteer work, it's like, oh, like... That gets me out of my head and
makes you grateful.
Makes me feel grateful for my situation. And so that's, maybe I need to return to that.
I think absolutely. I think you hit the nail on the head. And to me, volunteer work has saved my life. I'm telling you, when you do volunteer work, you get absolutely as much out of it as anybody that you're helping, sometimes more so.
I agree. That has helped me tremendously.
It helps you slow down when you can't slow down on your own. It's almost like a governor for anxiety.
I agree.
Let's go to a fear off.
Let's do it.
Okay. I am going to be reading the fears, continuing on a list of fears from a listener named Victoria. And she says, I'm afraid of being crushed by falling objects.
Crushed by falling objects?
Yeah. Yes. Actually, I think I've done that one already.
You switch to a different one?
Yeah, I'm going to go to her next one. She says, I'm afraid that people can hear my thoughts no matter how much I feel, no matter how much I tell myself it's not possible.
I'm afraid of the death of my kids and my parents.
How could you not be?
Yeah.
I'm afraid of being accused of a crime and being unable to convince people I am innocent. I have that one. It's so deep. I completely relate to that one.
Disappointing the people I love.
I'm afraid that even with medication and therapy, I won't be able to rise above my depression and anxiety.
Mine is, I have to qualify this one, authority. But authority in the form of corporations, teachers, executives, people who work in the human resources department specifically, because I kind of feel that that's like going to the office when you're a kid, and anyone in charge, with the exception of cops, firemen, mailmen, because I feel like I'm kind of cool with those people. So those types of authority, it's like, oh, they're the authority for good. But authority that I find threatening, like whenever I get called into the human resources department to have a meeting, we just want to talk to you. Yeah. It's never good. It's I'm going to be fired. It's a conflict with, you know, a coworker. I'm afraid of human resources department, but that those kinds of authority, like any executive in a company, even though I've met like great executives when I've worked at TV networks or whatever, there are good ones out there. Whenever I have to interact with one, I feel very nervous. Mm-hmm. So that it's a weird authority to be afraid of.
Human resources people can often overreact to you photocopying your balls during the day.
Haven't we all done that?
Victoria says, I'm afraid of answering the door when I'm home alone.
I'm afraid that I really am a failure at relationships with women and I will die alone.
I think so many people have that one. Victoria says, I'm afraid of bodies of water that are deeper than I am tall. I'm guessing she can't swim.
Mm-hmm. Deadlines.
I'm afraid of walking face first into a spider web. Did it last night.
This one is, I'm afraid that person I don't really know who I think might hate me because the last thing I said to them was really stupid and I can't stop thinking about it and wish I had said something different, but it was probably not a big deal. And I'm sure that other person isn't even thinking about that awkward, dumb, idiotic last thing I said, but I am. And I actually wrote that run-on sentence right there.
You are good. You are good, Chris Gore. Victoria says, I'm afraid of holding my emotions and exploding in a cliched, rage-filled workplace shooting.
That's awesome. Oh, no. I'm afraid of getting fired from a job.
She says, I'm afraid of dying before my mom and her finding my vibrator. That's awesome.
I think we all have sort of like, you have to have some sort of fail-safe way to get rid of all that porn.
You
right?
always think about that, you know, when you pop that porn in, the porn DVD. What happens if...
I've got a pretty good porn collection. I'm kind of proud of it. Some good European stuff. I would be proud. I think it's classy. It's arty.
Mm-hmm.
It's European. All right. Sorry about that. I'm afraid that I will never accomplish anything meaningful or useful, and I'll be remembered for nothing.
You realize that that's already untrue?
No. But, yeah, I mean, maybe it's great when other people say it.
It's never enough.
No, it's not.
Victoria says, I'm afraid people don't understand my sense of humor and misinterpret my sarcasm as bitchiness. Maybe it is, Victoria. I don't know.
I'm afraid of credit card debt.
I'm afraid that experiencing deja vu means there is something wrong with my brain.
I'm afraid of making customer service phone calls when I know that I will be on the phone for a while and the call may drop before I actually resolve the issue. And then I will have to make the call a second time and start all over again. And I actually fear that to the point where I avoid making customer service calls to begin with because the call drops and then I'm in this like constant loop of like, it takes me hours to resolve a simple
thing. So aggravating.
Yeah.
Victoria says, and this is her last fear, I'm afraid I sound like a maudlin cunt.
You know what? It kind of goes with mine. My last one is that my fear is that I really am an asshole.
Do you have a love list?
I do have a love list.
Let's do that.
All right. Let's go. Who should go first?
You go first.
Okay. Now, I just want to qualify this and to say this is aside from my kids. Family. This is
yes,
a love
the
list.
Generic ones. I like the more specific ones. We all know, you know, I love
right.
Kool-Aid.
Exactly. So this is aside from that.
Right.
Number one.
Kool-Aid. Could I have picked a fucking lamer yeah. one that some people might absolutely not like?
But hearing you say that, it's so hot right now. I kind of want some Kool-Aid.
It does sound good.
Number one. Internet, beer, porn, TV, video games. You know, like everyone.
Victoria says, I love in the spring and fall the way the sun will break through the clouds as it's setting and highlight everything golden against gray, dreary rain clouds.
Oh, that's beautiful. That is beautiful. Number two, cinema. The movie theater, it's my church.
Victoria says, I love the word, I don't even know how to pronounce this, T-A-I-G-A. Taiga? Taiga?
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't even know what it means.
Yeah. I don't know. Well, there you go.
Yeah.
Mine's simple. I love the small of a woman's back and ass. Basically the naked female form. I love naked females.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah, the part of a woman's body that has always turned me on, that kind of baffles me a little bit, is the back of a woman's neck. I don't know what it is. When women wear their hair up, I just find the back of the neck just irresistible.
Wow.
Victoria says, I love Edgar Allan Poe and Pablo Neruda.
I love Star Wars.
I love when I can get over my shyness and smile at strangers. I especially love when they smile back.
I love cuddling after sex, of course, and sex. That sort of cuddling and sex, I'm kind of combining those.
I love when people recommend a band they think I will like, and they are right.
I love the Smashing Pumpkins. That's so funny, the synchronicity.
Yeah.
Wow.
Victoria says, I love going to movies at a drive-in.
I love that, too. There's only two drive-ins left in L.A. area. That's a great one. I love a woman who will dress up during sex, especially a slave Leia.
Especially what?
As in a slave Leia outfit.
Oh, from Star Wars?
From Star Wars, yes. It's combining my nerdiness and my love of naked women.
That's awesome. I love that a woman would do that, too. Victoria says, I love the smell of onions and garlic sautéing on the stove. That does smell good.
That's good. I love doing something creative and the satisfaction that comes from making something from nothing, like art or a mod or a film or a podcast or a book or a piece of writing.
That's great. Victoria says, I love seeing elderly couples bickering in that loving way that only comes after years together and partial hearing loss.
That's fantastic. Oh, that's a great one. I love when the trailers start before a movie.
I love knowing the answer to Final Jeopardy, even better when the contestant doesn't get it.
It's a tie, Batman and zombies.
I love when people remember my favorite songs.
I love movie soundtracks.
I love reconnecting with an old friend and still getting along really well.
I love Amy Mann and her music.
I love eating grape tomatoes straight off the vine.
I love passionate arguments with friends at the bar at Comic-Con.
That needs to be more specific. and this is Victoria's last one. I love that since I have started my fear list, I have realized some of them are so ridiculous, I'm not afraid anymore. Oh, that's beautiful.
Wow, that is beautiful. And I have one last one as well.
Fucking synchronicity.
Perfect. My last one is, I love cleaning. Well, that's it for this episode of PodCRASH. I really want to thank Paul Gilmartin. Mental Illness Happy Hour is one of my favorite podcasts. He really helped me out. I feel like I saved money when I was hanging with him because by the end I felt really good. I felt like I've been on the couch for several hours. I feel like that 50 minutes is never enough. I always need more. So check out his podcast, subscribe to it. It's an amazing show. You can also go to mentalpod.com. You can follow Paul on Twitter @mentalpod. And also Mental Illness Happy Hour is on Facebook. So like them. Like Paul. He's doing an amazing show. One of my personal favorite podcasts. Also PodCRASH, right? Hey, @PodCRASH show. Follow me @ThatChrisGore. And Facebook, that's where you can get all the info. Facebook.com/PodCRASH. Go to PodCRASH.net. I hope to see you at this show Saturday, November 10th, 7 p.m. at the 2012 PodCRASH Awards. Would love to meet a lot of you listeners who've been listening for so long now. A year. Some of you have been listening for a year. I know, because I see the numbers steadily growing. I know there are people who started out at the beginning. I think you've stuck with us. So I'm just really pleased that you continue to listen. And I get to discover new podcasts because I've become a podcast junkie. I'm going to have to go back on Paul's show to actually go to rehab to stop being a podcast junkie. That's my new problem that I'm dealing with. And a final thing, and I say this with all sincerity,
And every time I say it now in my personal life, it actually kind of derails any conversation. Because when I say this, because this phrase actually comes up in normal conversation, actually a couple times a day, I can't say it now. I can't say it now because when I say this thing, it actually, I'm fully aware that this is now sort of the sign off of the show, which is, let's get out of here. Too shocking to see.
Now won't you leave me in my misery? Trouble, trouble, please be kind. I don't want no fight, and I haven't got a lot of time.
If you're still listening to this, you're probably a lot like me. You're the kind of person who stays through the end credits of movies, you listen to the end of podcasts, and you're the kind of person who collects the proof of purchase things on like all sorts of things like cereal, and then you'll send them in, and then you get like a prize, and you get something that if you didn't pay attention to that, you wouldn't have actually gotten that. I'm that guy. I'm very OCD. I'll collect those things, and I'll send them in. If you're listening to the end of this, and you're hearing this, you're hearing me talk about this, where I'm collecting the proof of purchases, and then we're a lot alike. And I like you. For that, you shall be rewarded. Now, a lot of you have sent in your self-addressed stamped envelopes, and you've received a little card in the mail. You're not getting that anymore. In fact, you can send in as many self-addressed stamped envelopes as you want. You're getting a brand new surprise. And that's our new PodCRASH fan club kit. I'm not going to tell you what's in the kit, but it's something really cool. And it's free, and you can only get it by sending in a self-addressed stamped envelope to me, at PodCRASH with that Chris Gore, 5042 Wilshire Boulevard, PMB 1500, Los Angeles, California, 90036. I'm going to send back the PodCRASH fan club kit, which is awesome. When you see the stuff that's in the fan club kit, when I was a kid, I loved fan club kits. Who remembers Bantha tracks? Well, you're not here to say that, but there's someone who's listening to this now who remembers Bantha tracks. Who knows that was the Star Wars fan club newsletter? How many fan clubs did you join as a kid? I joined a bunch of them. And they would send you a kit. I just love the word kit. What's in a kit? A fan club kit? That's so cool. So in celebration of our 52 shows, 1 year worth of PodCRASH, send a self-addressed stamped envelope. You will receive a PodCRASH fan club kit. That's the only way. You can get it by sending in the self-addressed stamped envelope. You'll also get more stuff if you come to one of our live shows. And we'll be announcing dates for 2013, the live PodCRASH tapings, which are going to be all over the place. One final thing. Later.